الحمد لله، نحمده سبحانه ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه، ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهدي الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا وعظيمنا وزعيمنا وحبيبنا محمدا صلى الله عليه وسلم قد بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة وكشف الغمة وجاهد في سبيل دينه حتى أتاه اليقين. فاللهم اجزه عنا وعن والدينا وعن الإسلام والمسلمين خير ما جازيت به نبيا عن قومه ورسولا عن أمته. اللهم أحينا على سنته، وأمتنا على ملته، واحشرنا تحت لوائه، وأوردنا حوضه، واسقنا من يده الشريفة شربة هنيئة لا نظمأ بعدها أبدا. اللهم آمين. We're continuing to tackle the issue of good manners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the subtitle today is about respecting the sunan and the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created this universe, He set laws for all of His creations. But among His creations are the two species, if you will, that are enjoying free will and free choice, the jinn and the humans. So everything else complies by being compelled by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah compels the sun to run the way it does. The moon runs the way Allah ordered it to do. وَالشَّمْسُ تَجْرِي لِمُسْتَقَرٍ لَهَا ذَلِكَ تَقْدِيرُ الْعَزِيزِ الْعَلِيمِ وَالْقَمَرَ قَدَّرْنَاهُ مَنَازِلَ حَتَّى كَانَ كَالْعُرْجُونِ الْقَدِيمِ عَادَ كَالْعُرْجُونِ الْقَدِيمِ. جزاكم الله خير. So everything in the universe is running according to Allah's will. When Allah called the heavens and the earth and ordered them to come forward and submit to Him by compulsion or by free choice, they said, we come voluntarily by our own volition. قالت أتينا طائعين. Amazing. So it looks like there are amongst our creations those that Allah orders and they obey. Angels are, as we are told in the Quran, in total complete compliance. لا يعصون الله ما أمرهم. They never disobey Allah. ويفعلون ما يؤمرون. And they do what they are commanded. So who's left? Who's the renegade? Who is the rebel? It is us and our friends the jinn. These are the two creatures that have free choices. So Allah sets laws and compels all of His creation to comply. And then there are laws that He sets for us to follow. Some of us do, some of us don't. We know what they are called. Those who come voluntarily to Allah, they are called Muslims. They are expected to submit all the time. Unfortunately, some of us, we submit. In fact, most of the Muslims would submit, but under certain conditions. We submit when the result is our benefit, so we love it. We submit to the judgment of Islam, to the rules of the Quran, when we know that the result is on our side. That the Prophet will judge for us, we submit. We submit when it is easy. And many of us, when you challenge them to comply, they say it's difficult. It's difficult to do this. It's difficult to live as a Muslim all the time. It's difficult to do 5 times daily prayers. I cannot fast because I work and I do this and I drive all the time. Things like this. So we find excuses always not to comply with Allah's rules. But the crux of being a Muslim actually is to comply. That's what being a Muslim is, to submit as ordered, to do as commanded. This is what submission is. So it is not good manners with Allah that we know what He expects and then we don't do it. But it is more of bad manners that we do this, we don't submit, and then we ask and we want Him to answer. Of course, Allah said in the Quran, "Ud'uni astajib lakum." You ask and I will answer. But He set conditions that we also, when He calls us, that we answer. Istajibu lillah walirrasul idha da'akum lima yuhyikum. Respond to Allah and to His Messenger when He calls you to that which benefits you, which gives you life. Life. And Allah doesn't invite us to anything except everything that gives us real life, better life, peaceful life. But then when we have a different opinion from that which Allah gives us, we tend to go to what we like. So we tend to obey Allah when His orders are consistent with our desires. Oh Sheikh, yes, of course, I'm coming for Allah's judgment and I have nothing. I will accept what you judge. Because they know that the judgment is going to be on their side. We spoke before that only hypocrites are described in the Quran as ones who, when invited to the judgment and the rules of Allah, they hesitate and they refuse. رَأَيْتَ الْمُنَافِقِينَ يَصُدُّونَ عَنْكَ صُدُودًا وَإِذَا دُعُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ لِيَحْكُمَ بَيْنَهُمْ. They are reluctant. They are not coming forward. Why? Because they are afraid the rule may not be on the side that they wish. So if we are to practice our deen the way it should be, then the thinking that we have must be switched from responding to Allah with conditions to responding to Allah unconditionally. This is a huge difference. Allah is the one who sets conditions. Allah is the one who would answer us when we meet His conditions. But you cannot condition Allah. You cannot condition Allah. So who is it to be conditioned? We are to condition ourselves. We are to change our ways of relating to Allah in a way that He is pleased with us. When does Allah become pleased with us? Whom does Allah love? Allah loves al-muhsineen. He loves al-muttaqeen. He loves people who are righteous, people who are good, people who are in compliance with Allah's expectations. Allah loves those who are forgiving to others, those who open new pages and give new chances to each other, those who are helpful to each other. Most of Allah's expectations after Tawheed and Ibadah are related to our relationship with each other. What is it? As if Allah is telling us, just be nice to each other and recognize that I am your Lord and act accordingly. Is this too much to ask? We ask Allah for everything there is and everything there isn't. Allah says, one of the sunan, that إِن تَنْصُرُ اللَّهَ يَنْصُرْكُمْ. If you support the cause of Allah, Allah will support your cause. He will support you. So now, why do we ask Allah for victory and support and dignity and honor and to be the best on earth, but then we don't comply? We don't meet Him where he wants us to be. How could this happen? It is like saying to immersion, for example, no comparison here, but you go to immersion and tell him, give me the best you have. So he packs you everything you want, puts it on the bench for you to pick, and then you want to take it without paying. Would he let you go? He wouldn't. There is nothing free in any relationship, including our relationship with Allah. But our relationship with Allah is 99% one-sided. Allah gives and forgives. We get and forget, which is the opposite. We should be thankful for what you get. لَإِن شَكَرْتُمْ لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ. If you are grateful for that which I already have given you, I'm going to give you more. No, we ask for more without offering gratitude for what we had already received. That means we are ignoring Allah's rules. And on this playground that is called the earth, Allah's rules will be kept. He is not going to respond to those who ignore him. That's part of the rules. So we have to be careful that we do not ignore Allah and expect him, subhanahu wa ta'ala, to pay attention to our needs. It's part of the rules of Allah that if you are merciful to his creation, you will deserve and receive the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Many of us are not exercising that rule rightly. We are not. We are not merciful. Or those of us who are merciful, they are not merciful enough or as often as we should. But Allah is the most merciful. We want and expect him to be merciful to us even when we are most miserable. So we go make sins and harm people and do this and then come back to Allah and he would say, if you make tawbah, I'm going to accept you. But just make a promise not to go back to the same felony, to the same mistake, to the same violation again and again. And expect that you will be allowed to take Allah for granted. But if you fall inadvertently without intention, you're always re-accepted, re-admitted to the fold of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why do people, I'm going to rephrase this, why do we Muslims take Allah for granted? Why do we take Allah for granted? We need to understand, because it works against common sense. We take no human being for granted, except for the ones who are very closest. Right? So we take our spouses for granted. We take our parents for granted, right? We take our children for granted. And sometimes we take our neighbors for granted. So it looks like our head is really lopsided. It's working like a pyramid that is standing on its head, not on its base. And that's why our life is always shaky. Because those who come closer to us are getting the worst of us. And those that we have a distance, socially or business-wise or in any other way, we deal with them very carefully. We don't want to lose business, so we are very careful how to deal with the boss and the environment at work, right? But when it comes to family, we take our spouses for granted. We scream at each other, we yell at each other, we abuse each other at times. Why? Because they are so close. What are they going to do? But do you know what? The Quran says, فَإِنَّهُ لَا يَأْمَنُ مَكْرَ اللَّهِ إِلَّا الْقَوْمُ الْكَافِرُونَ. You can take some people for granted, which is wrong. But if you take Allah for granted, the Quran is saying, only those who are kafirun, the disbelievers, are the ones who take Allah for granted. They think Allah will do nothing. They think Allah will do nothing. Which means I can do anything and I can play around the rules of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If nobody sees me, then I can play around the rules. And this is what's turning our life miserable. So we are like a person who's running against the current, and he thinks it gets him where he wants. And because he's cutting distance, even though with difficulty, he thinks he's getting where he wants. But with Allah, it doesn't ever work this way. You have to work with the sunnah of Allah. We ask Allah to take care of those tyrants and oppressive rulers, right? But Allah says, it's up to you. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِقَوْمٍ حَتَّى يُغَيِّرُوا مَا بِأَنفُسِهِمْ. It's one of the rules, one of the laws, that Allah will not change the condition or situation of a community and ummah until and unless they change what's in themselves. What do you love? What are your priorities? What do you care for? Whom do you fear? You have to change those components that give you the motives for your behavior. But if you don't change those motives, nothing will change. If you don't think that this bus takes you where you want, you will never take it. But if you think, even by mistake, that the bus in front of you will take you where you want, you will board it. It doesn't matter what. So we have to work with the rules of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then when the bus driver tells you, sir, this bus is not going that place, what do? You still ride it? You can, but if you do, you're not getting where you want. You're getting where the bus is going. So Allah says, choose your friends, because your friends here will be with you and you will be with them in the hereafter. Still, we choose the wrong friends and then we ask Allah to change us, to make us pious and good, while our friends take us to places that are not exactly godly, to actions and behaviors and situations that may even turn us against Allah. But we still pick up bad friends, bad ideas, and then say, but we are righteous. One of the rules of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that prayer should forbid us from doing anything wrong. إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ تَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ. So many of us say, okay, I will pray, but in between the prayer, I'm going to do anything else. As if the rule doesn't matter. Allah said, if you pray, you should be in compliance with Allah's expectations. We're saying, no, if I comply with one order, this should take care of any and everything else. Then the Prophet gives us details that between the prayers, Allah will forgive minor infractions, minor sins. بين الصلاة والصلاة كفارة لما بينهما من الجمعة إلى الجمعة كفارة لما بينهما من رمضان إلى رمضان كفارة لما بينهما. We hear this and we say, great, Allah forgives everything between prayer, everything between Friday prayer, everything between Ramadan and Ramadan. But the hadith continues to say, إِذَا اجْتُنِبَتِ الْكَبَائِرِ. If you avoid major sins. So major sins require what? To be removed. Specific tawbah. You cannot steal somebody's money or cheat in business and then expect Allah to forgive you or accept even your dua. You can't. Because there are rights for humans. You have to pay back those rights for you to be re-accepted in the fold of those who are ta'ibin, repenting. So there are rules that Allah sets for us in life, and the most unfortunate thing is we do not study to learn what those rules are. If we are to be certified with a license and the license says Muslim, it means you can walk the earth, you have a license. Allah gave you this license in the form of the contract where you said لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله, you have the license to walk this earth. In fact, walking this earth is allowed for anyone, even those who don't have this license. But to drive, there are different driver licenses, right? You cannot drive a truck unless you have a license for truck driving, right? But you can drive your small car, right? To say I'm driving as a Muslim in this life, I am walking this earth as a Muslim, you need to have a license that says and shows and proves that you have done your training, that you are watchful for the rules, so that you don't kill others or kill their faith while driving as a Muslim or claiming to be a Muslim. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in teaching us, رَبَّنَا وَلَا تَجْعَلْنَا فِتْنَةً لِلَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا. Don't make us a fitna. Don't make us a trial to those who have not believed. Because some of us are. By driving in the wrong direction and claiming you are a Muslim, by cheating on applications when you are a Muslim, by filing false papers and false documents, you are violating the license you have to walk this earth as a Muslim. That claim becomes false and it becomes injurious to your faith and to you. So we have to have some respect for the rules Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sets. One of the rules is in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, where he tells Mu'adh ibn Jabal, Sa'd ibn Mu'adh, Ya Sa'd, atib mat'amaka takun mustajab ad-da'wah. O Sa'd, make sure that every source of your earning is purely halal, so that your dua, your supplication to Allah is answered. How many of us really observe and watch that their earning is fully halal, fully pure, fully compliant with Allah's expectations? When some of us work in places they shouldn't, and they know. When some of us engage in business transactions they shouldn't, and they know it is prohibited. How could we then ask Allah in the hadith that a man would eat from haram and do everything haram, speak haram, and ask Allah, how could Allah answer him? مَلْبَسُوا حَرَامُ وَمَأْكَلُوا حَرَامُ وَمَبِيتُوا حَرَامُ فَأَنَّا يُسْتَجَابُ لَهُ. How could Allah respond to such a person? The Prophet is trying to tell us, being a Muslim is not about the claim, it is about the compliance. We need to look at this. Are we compliant? So brothers and sisters, before we ask Allah, we need to ask ourselves, are we compliant? Have we learned the sunnah of Allah? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he says, وَلَوْلَا دَفْعُ اللَّهِ النَّاسَ بَعْضَهُمْ بِبَعْضٍ, it's a sunnah, it's a law, that only by pushing people against each other that truth prevails and falsehood is smashed. بَلْ نَقْذِفُ بِالْحَقِّ عَلَى الْبَاطِلِ فَيَدْمَغُ فَإِذَا هُوَ زَاهِقٌ. But who's going to put the truth forward first? Allah leaves it on your shoulder. It is on our shoulder to push what is truthful, what is right, what is righteous, what is good. But if we are all silent until falsehood becomes the norm, until the cancer takes over the ummah's body, and then we say, oh Allah, it has been too long. You know, those tyrants are doing this, they are killing us, they are doing... All of those attitudes that we have, it is like a person who is sick, and the doctor says, you need to take those medications according to this schedule. Some don't buy the medication and they want to be cured. Some, they buy the medication but they don't want to take it. They don't really trust the doctor. They want to go somewhere else, either use herbs or anything else. So they bought the medicine, they don't want to take it. Some bought the medicine and they are taking it but not following the system. How could the medication work? Allah says, pray on those scheduled time, 5 times a day. Some of our Muslim community members, unfortunately, they say, I pray, but it is, I pray the whole 5 times at one time when I come home at night. Which is total disrespect, total disregard. Allah is calling us 5 times a day and we're saying, we don't have time for you. When we have time, when we're done. How much respect is there? How could this medicine of prayer work on our spirit, on our souls, on our hearts? How can it make us righteous? When in fact, we know that if we don't pray on time, our souls and our spirits are losing the food that they need to survive the stress of this life. And then we complain. There's a lot of anxiety, a lot of stress, a lot of tension in all relationships, and then we say, I don't know why Allah is doing this to me. No, you do. You just don't ask yourself. And some, they don't even check on what they are doing. Umar ibn Khattab used to say, حاسبوا أنفسكم قبل أن تحاسبوا. Hold yourself accountable before you are held to account. وزنوا أعمالكم قبل أن توزن عليكم. Weigh your deeds before they are weighed for you. When do we do this? We wake up and we're too busy to think. We're working the whole day, we're too busy to think. We go to sleep and we are too tired to think. We sleep and days and nights go by and years go by and we've never taken time to hold ourselves accountable. So when do we change? When do we start saying, I am living the wrong life? I'm disconnecting my soul from the source of its power. I'm depriving my spirit from the source of life. How could I have that real life? So Allah, to shake our conscience, He tells us that some people are living, they have hearts, but they cannot think right. They have eyes, but they don't see. They have ears, but they don't hear. Then the description comes down to, إِنْهُمْ إِلَّا كَالْأَنْعَامِ بَلْ هُمْ أَضَلِّ. They are like beasts and animals, they are even worse off. Because animals respond to Allah. Animals respond to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So brothers and sisters, if I leave you today only with one thing, that we should listen to the good advice of Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu, that we hold ourselves to account before we are held to account, and we weigh our deeds before they are weighed against us. And when we hold ourselves to account, we should resolve to change our ways with Allah. Because it's only when we have peaceful relationship with Allah that the rest of our relationships will be corrected. Basically, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, قلب المؤمن بين إصبعين من أصابع الرحمن يقلبه كيف يشاء. The heart of the believer is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he can turn it and turn it over this way or that way as he pleases. Which means if you have a problem with someone in your relationships, you should work your relationship with Allah first, because you need Allah's help to change that person's heart. Most of us, unfortunately, we ignore that and we don't want to change our side, but we want the other side to change 100%. It's not going to happen. Allah will always let you know that He's not happy by making your life more difficult. And he told us that in the Quran, وَمَنْ أَعْرَضَ عَنْ ذِكْرِي فَإِنَّ لَهُ مَعِيشَةً ضَنْكَ. He who turns away from my remembrance, he would lead a miserable life. So if your life is miserable or difficult or troublesome, check your relationship with Allah and ask yourself, do you hear him when he calls you? And then what do you do when you hear him? When he says, that action is wrong. And Allah speaks to us almost every single minute in our life. Whenever you have a choice to make or a decision to have, Allah always talks to you. Sometimes through your conscience. Sometimes he sends you somebody to ask you about an issue that you should answer in your own life. I see this in my experience more often than maybe many of you. When somebody comes to ask me a question, I know that Allah is sending me a message. I need to be careful. So before I respond to anybody about any issue, I ask, am I complying with what I'm going to say or not? And this is what I believe everybody should be doing. So Allah sends you messengers, either through dreams that you see at night, or people that come across in your life, or issues that are raised, or worries that you have, or relationships that you are destroying. So Allah is always talking to you. But the question is, are you paying attention? Are you listening to what he's saying? Allah spoke about those who do not listen to Allah, and he says, إِنَّ شَرَّ الدَّوَابِّ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ الصُّمُّ الْبُكْمُ الَّذِينَ لَا يَعْقِلُونَ وَلَوْ عَلِمَ اللَّهُ فِيهِمْ خَيْرًا لَأَسْمَعَهُمْ. If Allah knows they have goodness and righteousness in their heart, he would have made them hear him loud and clear. His voice will be louder than the voice of your needs, your wants, your desires, or even the devil is whispering. Allah's voice will be louder than all of the above. So when you notice that Allah is actually talking to you, that means that there is some good in you. That means your conscience is still alive and well. Don't suppress it. Don't suppress your conscience. Let alone that you should not kill it. Because if you suppress your conscience, you're gonna blind your eye, you're gonna deafen your ear, and you're gonna kill your heart. Our conscience is part of the secret of connection between us and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Our spirit is likewise. As I mentioned before, I believe that our conscience is at the core of our heart and our spirit. So we have to be careful that when we feel inside us that something is wrong, that it is Allah giving us this signal so that we pay attention. It's Allah talking to us. If we don't want to pay attention, if we ignore Allah's messages and signals and the alarms he sends us, then nothing will benefit us. إِنَّكَ لَا تَهْدِي مَنْ أَحْبَبْتَ. You can gather a whole community to tell somebody what is right and what's wrong, and it wouldn't benefit him. So brothers and sisters, as we could see, if we track the sunan of Allah, the laws by which he wants us to comply, and ask ourselves, are we in compliance with his expectations? Our life will change. Our thinking will change, our conscience will be up and running, and our relationship with Allah and with each other will be improved, inshallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us to do the right thing. الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وصحابته ومن اتبع سنته بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. So we understand, I hope, that good manners with Allah requires that we comply with Allah's expectations. And every choice we have in our life has two sides to it, that you are either pleasing to Allah or you are displeasing to Allah. When we are displeasing to Allah, we are very pleasing to the shaitan and to our whims and desires. So there is something about this that I need to draw everybody's attention to. When something is very pleasing to our desires, we have to question, are we satisfying this desire in the right way or in the wrong way, in the halal way or in the haram way? Because there is nothing of the human desires that are natural that is not compliant with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You can always satisfy all of your desires, just follow the rules of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You can satisfy your physical desires by either eating halal materials, food and produce and other things, or by scavenging anything, halal or haram. You can either eat only from halal sources, from halal money, or from other sources, scavenge anything, like animals grazing in the jungle. Every choice and every decision we make has these two aspects to it. There is no third aspect. So we have to be careful. When something is very pleasing, are we getting it? Are we satisfying our need for it in a halal way or in a haram way? Are we putting it on the top of a priority that Allah wants us to do? Or is it the priority of the moment? Is it the time to do it? Because part of the gifts that Allah gave us come in the form of intangibles. Like we take our health for granted, so it becomes intangible. We don't feel it until we get sick. Likewise, time. We don't feel time until we are pressed for a deadline or a specific, you know, important meeting or travel schedule. But other than that, we take our time for granted. Our life also is almost intangible. We take it for granted that if I don't do something today, I will do it next year. We are so hopeful, falsely so, that tomorrow is certainly coming, and next year is certainly coming, and next 10 years are certainly coming. And that is true in a way. Tomorrow is coming, but I may not be here. That's a catch. Next year is coming, but who says I will be here? So if I don't make Hajj this year, and I have the means, and I say, this year, no, but next year. And I have not made it before, what do I do to myself, to my interest? So sometimes we make choices based on either lust, comfort, pleasure, or convenience. Those are the wrong measures to make decisions. Our decisions should be based on one of two things. Either that we see our interest in them, or we see that they are very pleasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when something seems to be in our interest, but we know that it is not pleasing to Allah, we must submit. It is not in our interest. We are just deceiving ourselves. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide us to do the right thing all the time. اللهم اهدنا فيمن هديت وعافنا فيمن عافيت وتولنا فيمن توليت وقنا واصرف عنا شر ما قضيت. اللهم اقسم لنا من خشيتك ما تحول به بيننا وبين معصيتك، ومن طاعتك ما تبلغنا به جنتك، ومن اليقين ما تهون به علينا مصائب الدنيا. ومتعنا اللهم بأسماعنا وأبصارنا وقوتنا ما أحييتنا، واجعله الوارث منا، واجعل ثأرنا على من ظلمنا، ولا تجعل مصيبتنا في ديننا، ولا تجعل الدنيا أكبر همنا ولا مبلغ علمنا، ولا إلى النار مصيرنا. وإذا أردت بقومنا فتنة فنجنا منها يا مولانا، غير خزايا ولا مفتونين ولا مبدلين ولا مغيرين. اللهم لا تدع لنا في يومنا هذا ذنبا إلا غفرته، ولا دينا إلا قضيته، ولا هما إلا فرجته، ولا كربا إلا نفسته، ولا ضالا إلا هديته، ولا مبتلا إلا عافيته، ولا سائلا إلا أعطيته، ولا ميتا إلا رحمته، ولا حاجة لنا من حوائج الدنيا والآخرة لك فيها رضا ولنا فيها صلاح وفلاح إلا يسرتها وهيأتها لنا يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم انصر عبادك المجاهدين في كل مكان، اللهم انصر إخواننا في غزة، وانصر إخواننا في فلسطين، وانصر إخواننا في العراق وفي سوريا وفي مصر وفي اليمن وفي ليبيا وفي تونس وفي كل مكان. اللهم انصر الإسلام وأعز المسلمين، وأعلي بفضلك يا رب كلمتي الحق والدين. اللهم انصر إخواننا في أفغانستان، وانصر إخواننا في باكستان. اللهم حرر الإسلام والمسلمين من تحت سياط الطغاة الجبارين. اللهم عليك بالطغاة الجبارين فإنهم لا يعجزونك. اللهم أرنا فيهم آيات قدرتك وعجائب معجزاتك فإنهم لا يعجزونك. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم، فستذكرون ما أقول لكم، وأفوض أمري إلى الله، إن الله بصير بالعباد. وأقم الصلاة.
الله أكبر الله أكبر، أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله. حي على الصلاة، حي على الفلاح، قد قامت الصلاة، قد قامت الصلاة. الله أكبر الله أكبر، لا إله إلا الله.
استقيموا واستووا واعتدلوا.